Good morning, students.
Students,
I am Mudaliar here, and today we have got a very passionate teacher for you. She is Srila Bhattacharya. She has done MA and B.Ed, and she has 30 years of experience of teaching. She has been teaching in Swami Vivekananda Junior College. She has been moderator for HSC board exam, and she has worked very closely with chief moderator to decide the first 25 top cases. So she knows all finer points of your marking system also. So today you are in best hands. So just sit back and enjoy the session. Over to Srila madam.
Thank you, ma'am. Very good morning to Veena ma'am and Goli ma'am and all my dear children. So this new format of English paper is very different from what you had, what was there last year or the years before, because it is the pattern in the sense that 80 marks prose and 20 marks will be oral. But certain changes are there which you have to be very, very careful, and you have to remember when you are going to answer the question paper. So we begin with section 1, prose, reading for comprehension, language study, summary, mind mapping. So comprehension will be from your scene lessons, scene extract. So 1 to 8, we have 8 prose lessons. From those 8 prose lessons, any one will be selected, and your word limit for the extract will be 275 to 300 words. The first question will be on global understanding. That is, after reading the extract, you've got to answer the question, keeping in mind, you know, what association. It could be in the form of true, false. It could be in the form of correct. The true, false, generally they set a question, pick out the true, false, state the true and false statement, and correct the false statement. So you have to read the extract very, very thoroughly to know what is the correct answer. Then sometimes they may give you some jumbled sentences from that extract. You have to arrange it. So that is global understanding. Complex factual, again, carries 2 marks. Inference and interpretation. This question is going to carry 2 marks. You've got to answer in not more than 2 sentences. Maximum 3, not more than that. Because if you keep on writing a lengthy answer, you'll not be able to complete your question paper. You'll not be able to complete your answers. So you have to restrict it to 2 sentences. Then comes the personal response. Personal response is again, what do you think? Did you come across such a situation like that? And that also has to be restricted to 2 sentences. Please don't write lengthy answers, because the examiner is going to have 300, 325 odd papers. They will not bother to read your lengthy answers, and they will not give you marks. So personal response, 2 marks. In all these questions, if your answers are perfect, without any grammatical mistake, without any spelling error, you will get full 2 out of 2. But if there is a red mark from the examiner's side, then you will lose half or one, whatever. That depends totally on the examiner. Language study will be 2 sentences from the passage given and 1 vocabulary. Vocabulary could be your give the noun forms, give opposites, give synonyms, similar words, whatever, vocabulary. Then we come to the non-textual grammar. Non-textual grammar will be do as directed or transformation of sentences. So that will carry 3 marks. So you may get fill in the blanks with correct preposition, fill in the blanks with correct article, etc., etc. And or you may also get, say, change into negative, change into a simple sentence. So generally, you have to be very, very thorough with your grammar. Then this is a new thing that they have introduced, spot the error. There will be a sentence and there will be a mistake in the sentence. So you have to point out the error. What is the mistake in that particular sentence? Okay, I hope I'm clear. Okay, then we come to question 2A. Now, question 2A will be an unseen passage. This will be an unseen extract. The word limit will be 275 to 300, same. The questions will also be same. Global understanding, complex factual, inference, interpretation or analysis, your personal response question, your language study and your vocabulary. This will be your 2A, same as 1A. Now we come to 2B. Now 2B is summary writing. What are the rules of a summary writing? You will be the same passage which I already told you, that is, you will be getting a passage here. A summary writing will be an unseen the extract, the similar, the whatever extract is given, that is extracts summary you have to write. So when you write a summary, what points should you keep in your mind? You have to read the passage at least 2 to 3 times. You have to read it. Once you read it, you have to in your mind remember the important points and what is the core message in the passage. What is the message that the passage is carrying? Based on that, you will immediately think of a title. Now, the extract may be written in 2 paragraphs, 3 paragraphs. You have to write the summary in 1 paragraph only. That is a point given in the model answer paper given by the board, that the summary should be in 1 paragraph. Okay. Now, 1/3 of the length. Now, you may be wondering, how do I count that 1/3? What you will do, children, when you get the question paper, very fast for the second B, that is unseen extract, which is a summary writing passage, you will take the second line. Second line, you will count the number of words. And then horizontally, you will count how many lines are there in the passage. Multiply. Supposing the line is containing 7 words and we have, say 100 lines. That means 7 into 100. So how many lines? It will not be such a lengthy passage. Okay, let us reduce it. Say 30 words, 30 lines. So 7 words on each line and 30 lines. So that gives me 210 words. The passage is carrying 210 words. I have to reduce it to 1/3. So my passage will be of 70 words. Now, how will you know 70 words? You're not going to write and count those words. So what you approximately know that how many words I can fit in one paragraph and one line. Maybe I can write 5 words on one line. So for me, how many lines will I take? I may be taking these many lines and that will be my 1/3 length of the summary. Now, one more thing which you will remember is when you will be answering these questions, especially your global understanding, complex factual, inference, the main points of the summary will be given in these 3 questions. So if you answer, supposing this question has come in the form of true, false, and you have noted down which is the correct statement, you have noted down which is the false statement, and you have corrected that false statement. Are you getting it? So what is the true, what is the true, sentence and what is the false, what was the incorrect statement given and what was the correct statement given. The correct statement has no problem, you've noted down. Incorrect statement, you have corrected it. So you've got the correct point. So mainly these three questions, if you answer it carefully, your 3/4 of your summary writing work is done. Am I clear? I hope I'm clear. So this is the third point, 1/3 of the length. Then we come to the third person. Many a times you will find that in the passage, I is used, first person. You is used, second person. In that case, all these I's and you's will be converted to third person. He, she, it. No using the first person and second person. Everything should be in the third person. No examples. The passage, the paragraph, the extract may contain examples. You will not give any examples. And there may be direct speech. That, for example, the captain of the ship asked, comma, open inverted comma, how far are we from the shore? So when you are writing the summary, you will not write it in this form. The captain asked the crew, how long were they from the shore. Understood? So every time remember that the summary should be in reported speech. So title is a must, one paragraph, 1/3 of the length, third person, no example, reported speech. Okay, I hope I'm clear. Okay, next we come to the, next question, 2C. 2C is, this is mind mapping. Mind mapping. So you have to, a topic is going to be given to you. You have to map it out in your mind. Now map, you all have studied geography. You all have done map pointing, the places, rivers, mountains. So we have a map in our mind. So here the idea, the thought and the concept that you're going to illustrate will be from the topic given to you. So what is mind mapping? Okay, mind mapping. Now supposing what is mind mapping? This PPT has come, the first one. Anyway, I'll explain to you, then you'll understand. What is mind mapping? Diagram for representing tasks, words, concept or items linked to and arranged around a central concept or subject. There will be a central topic. For example, if I take football, that will be my central subject. From the central subject, I will have four ideas. I will have four ideas and each idea will have two more or three more or four more, which will be sub idea. So the main idea, from main idea, the main subject, we have four ideas. And each idea has sub idea. So task will come. When I'll explain the next one, you'll understand. Words, concepts, items linked to and arranged around a central concept or subject. Non-linear graphical layout. We don't have any graph over here. And build an intuitive framework. Intuitive means I assume my thought process goes in this manner. What manner? See, playground. What is my thought process? First is football. That is the main idea. From this main topic, we have two idea. One is playground and one is ways of learning. And from the playground, we have sub idea. What are these? Okay, before that, this point also. 1 minute. Huh? Why is that gone? Okay, central idea. The main idea, subject or focus is crystallized in a central image. It emphasizes the key thought. What is the key thought? The key thought is football. From football, I'm branching it out. Two thoughts have come to my mind. One is playground and one is ways of learning. Topics of lesser importance are represented as twigs of the relevant branch. So twigs means small branches. So twigs are actually what? Twigs are the sub idea. Now, when we talk about playground, where are we going to learn this football? We are going to practice in the playground. where all these playgrounds can be found. It could be your college playground, it could be a nearby park, or you would have to drive down, or let us put it in simple words, we'll cycle it out and we'll reach the playground. How are you going to learn? Are you going to take the help of your friends, or are you going to have a coach to assist you, to teach you? So is this part clear? So football is the main subject. We have idea, playground and ways of learning, and sub idea. Okay, now I have taken another one, birthday party. The main themes radiate from the central image as branches, associates. The branches comprise a key image or keyword drawn or printed on its associated line. This is all already explained. The branches form a connected nodal structure. Now, birthday party. Birthday party, again, when I'm going to organize a birthday party, what thoughts will come to my mind? Whom am I going to invite? Where will I host this birthday party? Who am I going to invite? Am I going to invite only my friends? Am I going to invite my close relatives? Am I going to invite my building people? Venue, where am I going to have it? Am I going to book a small hall? Am I going to have it at my own place? And what will be the menu? Whether it will be snacks or whether it will be dinner. So these thoughts, I'm planning it out. I'm just planning it. Okay. Then we come to, why do we do mind mapping? Why? What are the benefits of it? Memorizing. We need to remember many things, you know. We mentally put it in our head that, yes, these are the points I have to plan out when I'm going to organize a party. As you are memorizing, you're organizing the ideas. You're keeping it in mind whether I'm going to have games. What kind of games am I going to have? Brainstorming sessions. Attractive presentation. Am I going to have, how am I going to present it? How am I going to present the party? Simplify complex ideas. That there may be many ideas which may be very, very complex in your mind. But when you are presenting it, make it very, very simple. Mind mapping also helps in problem solving. You are mapping it out step by step. So your problems are solved. You are exploring new ideas. What ideas can you bring in when you are doing this mind mapping and executing group projects and plans? This is not only regarding football and birthday parties, but when you are in an office, in a company, in a corporate, so there you have been given a project. So what all factors of this project are you going to tackle? Who is your client? Who are the team members? When are you going to begin? How are you going to plan? Are you going to design the project, etc., etc.? So this mind mapping helps in proper planning. Okay, now we'll come to this birthday party. In details, I've done it. Birthday party. Now, first point comes as invitation. Invitation. Whom am I inviting? As I told you, friends. Am I inviting my relatives? And am I inviting my neighbors? How am I going to decorate? Am I going to have a theme? Nowadays, the theme system concept is very common. Am I going to have a theme? And am I going to decorate my room, my place, wherever I'm hosting it, according to the theme, make posters? Or I'll just put balloons and make it very simple. Am I going to have activities? If so, what kind of activities? Am I going to have games? Am I going to have karaoke music? And along with music, dance. I may have some games associated with this music, musical chairs, passing the parcel. Will that be all associated? Then coming to return gifts, who all will be my invitees? Am I going to give them return gift? What kind of gifts am I going to give them? Am I going to give them perfumes, or am I going to give them gift vouchers so that they can encash and buy something? Then menu, the most important thing. What kind of menu am I going to have? Cake? What will be the food? Whether I'm going to give them light snacks when they come and then serve dinner, or will be that 7 o'clock lunch snacks all combined and beverages. Venue, where is it going to be? I said the first point, home. Am I going to have it at my own place? Whether I'll book a small hall, whether it will be in the lawn of a restaurant, or I'll book the banquet hall in a restaurant. So this is how you are going to think. Now, for the question paper, some points will be given to you. The remaining, you have to think and you have to use your imagination. But children, please be fast. Don't waste a lot of time on thinking. Then what happens is, you'll not get time to complete the other question. Okay? Okay. Then we come to, this is mind mapping done. Then I come to poetry. Now, for poetry, we have this time two questions, two extracts. First will be the extract given from your section 1 to 8, one poem will be given. And that poem, from that extract, there'll be only 10 to 15 lines that will be given in the form of an extract. So it's more or less the same: global understanding, inference, interpretative analysis, personal response, poetic device will be in the form of your figures of speech. Now, creativity. Creativity will be the, from the theme of the poem, you will be asked to compose 2 to 4 lines. 2 to 4 lines you will be asked to compose. For example, the third poem, Inch Cape Rock. Or let us take up Indian Weavers, the second poem. And from there, you've been asked to compose 4 lines on weavers. When you are composing these 4 lines, children, please remember that follow some rhyme scheme if that poem is having rhyme scheme. Indian Weavers has rhyme scheme. So follow some rhyme scheme and please also follow, give some punctuation marks. Don't just write the lines and leave it. No, put some punctuation mark, insert some punctuation mark. So what happens, you know, the poem becomes very, very attractive. Your paper should be the best amongst all the others. So when examiner will get your paper, the examiner will look at your paper with awe. Yes, this paper is different from all the other papers that I corrected. So let me read the poem and use your imagination. Write a nice 4 lines, you know, which will strike the attention of the examiner, and he will feel that, yes, this child has some knowledge about literature. Okay, so this is question number 3A, which is going to carry 10 marks. Now I come to appreciation. Now, appreciation is a new topic this time given. Poems appreciation, critical appreciation, and the poem will be given to you. It's not that you have to memorize the poem and go for the exam. You will be given 10 to 15 lines will be given, and you have to write a critical appreciation. Now, what is this critical appreciation? First point that you will include is about the poem and about the poet. For example, if you take Indian Weavers, you will write one line about Sarojini Naidu. You will write something about she was a patriotic person. Her poems have a touch of, you know, associating with human life, etc. And about her, she was a very, very famous poet and a legendary figure in the field of English, Indian English poet. Okay. Then about the title, Indian Weavers. So this poem is about the Indian weavers, associating how the weavers are weaving and how we can associate this with our lives. What is the theme of the poem? That also will be written. Poetic style. What style has the poet been used? For example, Indian Weavers is written in iambic tetrameter. That is the style of the poem, iambic tetrameter. So that is to be mentioned. The language, poetic devices. The poet has used simile, metaphor, imagery. All these things will be mentioned. Now, you will not write the lines. You will not write the lines, but you will just say in general, the poetess has used simile, metaphor, imagery, inversion, etc. Special feature. What are the special features, if at all, in the poem? What message, value, moral is the poem carrying? Inch Cape Rock. Inch Cape Rock teaches us, as you sow, so you reap. If you do good, good will come back to you. If you do bad, you will definitely encounter a bad situation. So deeds are very important. That is the message and that is the moral. Your opinion. If you have to write anything about the poem, about the poet, so critically you are looking at it. You can give your own opinion about it without a second thought. Clear? So this is your critical appreciation. Okay. Then I go to the next question. Appreciation is done. Now the most important question. Section 3, writing skills. Please listen to this very carefully. This question carries 16 marks. There are 12 writing skill topics. Okay. All these 12 writing skill topics will be set in the question paper. Now this, for example, 4A, you will be given attempt any one, but virtual message, statement of purpose, group discussion. All the three questions will be given. You have to write any one. 4B, all the three will be given. Email, report writing, interview. You have to write any one. So 4 + 4, 8 marks. 4C, you have to write any one. Speech, comparing, expansion of idea, any one. Then 4D, any review, blog, appeal. You have to write any one. So you are going to write 16 marks question. But question set will be definitely, that will come to it later. So this question is very, very important. You prepare, I will not say prepare all because there will be a choice, but prepare at least two from each. Prepare at least two from each and go for the exam. Okay, so let us come to this. Drafting a virtual message. Okay, virtual message. Now, virtual classes, we are having virtual classes now. So what is a virtual message? Communication is an integral part of human nature. Exchange of ideas, thoughts, and information is communication. Communication can be in various forms. One could be, so communication, we need to communicate. We are human beings. Can we just sit without communication? No. Even if I'm happy, I need to communicate. If I'm sad, I need to communicate. I need to exchange my thoughts. I need to exchange my ideas. How do I do? I can do it orally. Orally, I can talk to each other. Written, I can write and I can send it to you. Or virtual, as we are doing it now. Now, written communication in our days was a bit, I mean, it was only written communication. We did not have mobiles. We did not have any, all your WhatsApp and Twitter and Instagram. None of these things we had. So we had to write. We had to write letters on postcards, on inland letters. We had to send telegrams to reach something very, very important at the fastest possible time. And virtual is what we are having now, online. Okay. A message is an informed means of communication. Why? Why? How? Why? Reason for send. Why are we sending messages? Why? What is the need? We are sending messages to inform. We are sending messages to express feelings. Now, you are going to appear for your board exam 12th standard. You will get a very good percentage. So the moment you get a good percentage, you inform everybody around. You get into a good college by clearing your CET. You feel very happy. You express your feelings. Imagine. Sometimes we imagine and we send messages. Sometimes we send messages to influence others. This is very much associated with our appeal question, where we are going to influence people, where we are going to persuade people to think about what you are talking and to meet social expectations. So these are the reasons why we send messages. In general, you can say that there are four types of messages. Four types. One is positive, one is negative, one is neutral, and one is persuasive. So positive, you know, positivity. Negative is just the opposite. Neutral, neither positive nor negative. And persuasive, I'm indirectly forcing someone to agree to what I say. Okay, now we come to, this was all regarding messages. All regarding messages. Now we come to the topic, what is a virtual message? 1 minute, where is that gone? Okay, what is a virtual message? Virtual, it is a mode of communication that includes the use of technology, audio and videos to communicate with people who are not physically present in front of us. How today I'm conducting this session. You people are there, but I cannot talk to you. I can only see you if you keep your videos on. So it is a part of communication with the system of audios and videos, that kind of a thing. There are six types of messages. One is directional message, one is messages of possibility, messages of reality, messages of necessity, new idea messages, and reframing messages. Okay, so we will take it up. I'll just discuss this. Not very much in details, but just the points I've touched. Directional messages. Direction, the very word direction means what should you do. So they give us a point on the best way to achieve a certain goal. So they are giving you your direction. Possibility, a message that says something else is possible. One may feel, one is very, very upset. One is very, very depressed, especially during this pandemic. We all sometimes, you know, there were phases when we used to feel very depressed. The road was absolutely lonely. Not a single person on the road. No sound of any vehicle. No sound of children playing. So the atmosphere was so gloomy and dull. So we feel very hopeless. We feel very helpless. That time when a good message comes, you know, like this is a phase, it will all be over, and always think of the others who are in a worse situation than you, then what happens? Our energy gets boosted. So we feel very, we don't feel low anymore. Messages of reality. Sometimes the message is about how things really are. They are clarifying messages, mini maps that help direct people from confusion to clarity. When things are made clear to us, when we are confused, but the message brings us clarity. Messages of necessity, what we need to do. It is more of a call to arms for people. It's not just a message of what is possible or what's real, but what's required of us to get what we want. So what should we do? We should not be living in a kind of a dilemma, do this or do that. No. This is what you should do. A very, very clear message of what needs to be done. New idea messages. Some messages are based on ideas that people may never have considered before. Messages with novel ideas and opinions. Good ideas. Give us, during this lockdown, you know, sometimes this is, I will not exactly call this a message, but what we come to know from what the others did, how they, whatever little savings they had, how they made use of it. They managed to survive, you know. Then, so these are very, very new messages, motivating messages, which we can always use in our daily lives when we are in this kind of a situation. Reframing messages. Some messages are about taking aspects of our life that we might have framed as weakness or bad, and framing them as strength or something we thought was bad is actually good. Now, so, thought it to be bad, but actually good. For example, this entire period was spending time at home. The good part of it, spending time with your parents. Otherwise, your whole day is college and your classes. So spending time with your home. So this was a positive part of your lockdown. Pollution had reduced drastically. The mountain range, the Himalayan range could be seen from Punjab. So pollution was tackled by the environment because there was no movement of any vehicle. So these were the good things, you know, out of the bad thing, the pandemic that happened. Okay. Then when you are framing a message, you should have the date, you should have the time, you should name the person to whom you are sending the message. Then you will write the message, and then you will write the sender, the name of the sender who is sending the message. What things should you remember? Only the important details should be given. Grammatically, you should not make any mistake. If that is a perfect, then you can get 3.5 out of 4. Prefer active voice. Always use active voice. Active voice. Subject plus verb plus object. I very simple sentence I'm giving you. I was reading a book. Not the book was being read by me. No passive voice. It has to be active voice. Indirect or reported speech should be used. As I gave the example in the summary writing, do not use any direct speech, all indirect speech. Express the whole ideas in a few words, very less words. Don't keep on being carried away and keep writing and writing. And this is not a letter. It is just a message. But one more thing, no giving any short forms, like as you do for your WhatsApp. No, clear writing. If it is say coming, C-O-M-I-N-G, not C-O-M-N, no, C-O-M-N or C-O-M-G, no. Meeting, M-E-E-T-I-N-G, not M-T-N-G, no short forms to be given. You have to be very friendly and polite. Don't be rude, you know, be polite, be friendly, as if you are sending a message to a person whom you respect. The message should be written in simple language and, as I said, without any abbreviations. No abbreviations, and simplest of the languages you are going to use. Don't. Avoid pun, ambiguity, criticism. Pun means what? When one word has two meanings, you're not going to use such a word. Ambiguity, the person should understand. The person should not think whether the person means this or the person means that. No. Criticism in short words that could create confusion. No criticism, because criticism is going to create confusion. And don't repeat any word. Don't repeat any sentence. Clear? Okay. Then I've given some examples, types of messages, that is requesting information, expressing preference, wishing for birthdays, asking for advice, expressing like or dislike, warning somebody, bidding farewell to somebody, asking for help or support, and stating. That is motivational, suggesting, joining, conversation, refusing, saying no, explaining, offering, etc., etc. The same thing is being done. Okay. Then we go to the next one. 1 minute. Let me check out. Yes. Statement of purpose. Statement of purpose. Yes. Statement of purpose is used when one goes abroad, mostly. When one goes abroad for higher studies, they apply along with the letter of application, statement of purpose. What is the purpose? Why are you going there? You know, to study. What is your aim? So what is it? The SOP is an application essay. A student applying for a graduate or postgraduate and doctorate level program at a foreign university is required to write in order to be admitted to the program. As I said, whether you are doing post-graduation, whether you are doing a PhD, or also if you are doing a graduation course after 12th, you are going there to study. In that case, you have to write an SOP. Why do the universities ask? Why do they ask for it? The SOP helps colleges and universities to decide if the applicants are really interested in the program that they have applied for. Now, when one is writing an SOP, the university has a committee who reads these SOPs. So the university will understand whether the applicant is really interested or just for the sake of applying, he or she is applying. Their ability to pursue the program and complete it successfully. Will they be able to, after they get the admission, will they be able to continue with the program? Whether they'll be successful in completing that program. So that is the reason that they, whether they will be able to continue. Whether they will be able to contribute. Now, whenever you have joined an university, think of your own college. You are contributing to the institution also. How are you contributing? You at your level, 12th standard, you are going for competitions. You are winning prizes. And there at the ward level, they know, oh, the child has come from so-and-so school. That child has to be good because that institution always wins prizes. So in this case, what will it be? It will not be prize. It will be your placement, your campus placement. So when you go from a good university, and you get employed in a good, in one of the best companies, what happens? That company knows that, yes, this institution, say, for example, if I take MIT, anybody coming from MIT will get admission. Understand? Will get the job. So MIT has a very good network with you, with the university where you are studying and the company where they are getting. For example, say MIT recruits, Deloitte company recruits from MIT. So Deloitte company knows that, yes, it is worth recruiting from MIT. So you will be able to contribute your institution's name, make name and fame of your institution. Okay, a good SOP. What should a good SOP have? It helps candidates present themselves successfully in the job market, as I said, helps applicants to highlight their strength during the admission process abroad. What are your strengths? Don't mention your weakness. I know, hardly. You should never talk about it because you could always overcome your weakness. Weakness should never be a point to be highlighted. Strength is something which is always to be highlighted. Attracts the admission officers who wade through hundreds of applicants. Many, many, many SOPs come. But why is your SOP different? Because you do possess these qualities. Importance of SOP in admin process. The SOP is considered to be one of the most critical components of the application. It portrays the most significant impression of yourself to the admission officers. You are the admission commission is not able to see you, but reading that SOP is getting a very, very clear picture about yourself. What are your likes? What have you done? 10th standard and 12th standard, how much percentage have you scored? Graduation, what were your subjects? Why you wish to pursue this particular course? You want to go for MArch, Masters in Architecture, or you want to take up, say, Electrical Engineering or Civil Engineering, MS, etc., etc. SOP will say a lot of things about you silently that a strong profile might never be able to speak out. Now, when you go for an interview, supposing they take an interview online, you will not be able to boast about your qualities. I am done this, I am doing this, I have done this. No, but you can write it down. So a lot of things can be written very, very quietly, written and submit. SOP tells your attitude, your ambition, your clarity of thought and personality. Your attitude. All of us have attitude, but that attitude should be positive. Positive. Your ambition. What is your ambition? Why you wish to pursue this? For example, civil engineering. I've done my B.Tech in civil engineering and I'm going to take up MS in structural engineering. So why I want to take up structural engineering? Because I want to do something related to this. Your thought has to be very, very clear, because it's not that something you say and once they interview you, they find it something different. And once you enter the college, again, something different. No, there should be total synchronization between your thought and your personality. GPA and test scores, what your GRE, all those tests are given, that is already given. And those are the objective and SOP is the subjective. It gives you the real opportunity to stand out from the crowd. A good SOP always wins the admission or the admission commission. Okay. Format. Now, format is given in the textbook also, but I've just jotted down a few points here. The format will be, it will be written in four paragraphs and one conclusion. Okay. So the first paragraph and 500 words. The first paragraph will give your background, your mental makeup, and your aim in life. The second paragraph will give why you wish to join this course, as I discussed earlier, your area of interest. Now, one more thing I want to go back. Personal background. Personal background will be your 10th standard, 12th standard, your graduation, etc. Mental makeup, I already mentioned. Aim in life. What is your aim in life? Why are you taking up this? Then, aim in life and this more or less can be similar. Your area of interest. You've done, as I said, engineering in civil. But what is your area of interest in which you wish to do MS? You will not be doing MS in civil engineering, but a particular thing. Then your qualities that would be helpful and suitable for this career or objective. Now, many of you will be doing engineering and you will be going in for, say, internship. Okay, after third year. If I have any art students, they will be taking up internship also. If you go to good institutions where they have this internship capacity format, you will be doing there. Then those of you who will be taking up commerce, say banking, etc., you may get internship to work and find out all the pros and cons of these banking services. Go join an insurance company for your internship 3 months, etc. So that will give you about your qualities. You can mention that this I've done internship. So this is what I pursue. I would like to pursue. Your hobbies. What do you like? Are you a reader? Do you like to play? For boys, it could be cricket, hockey, etc. For girls, it could be badminton, swimming. You've taken part in tournaments, badminton tournaments, sports competitions, and you've won laurels. You can mention that. Your experience, as I said, internship, you could mention over here. And you are different from the others. Something which is different. You have that capacity, you have that quality which others don't have. So that you have to mention. And why you want admission, how would it help you? And in the long run, how is it going to influence your career? Okay, so this is what you have to remember when you're writing an SOP. Okay, my next would be, 1 minute. Okay, how to write an SOP. These points are mentioned. The language should be very clear, simple. Do not make any mistakes or spelling or grammatical. Very, very convincing. You have to convince them. And you have to show that you are a determined person. Determined person means you will do it. You will be able to complete the course in case there is any hassle. But you will be able to complete because you are a very, very determined person. Your purpose of choosing. Why have you chosen this university? And why have you chosen this course? And always I tell you, when you write an essay, now we don't have essay in our portion. But whenever you write, you know, your thought is reflected. And through that thought being reflected, the personality is reflected. The thought process brings out our personality. Then your qualities, life experience, as I already mentioned, your self-respect, tell the purpose, demonstrate passion and potential, and add some uniqueness to make it personal. So these points you have to remember when you're writing an SOP. Okay. My next would be group discussion. Okay. Okay. What is group discussion? Now, group discussion, we come to, I have put in 3 points. One is definition, rules, and question answers. We are not going to have it. Definition. What is group discussion? Group discussion refers to a communicative situation, a discussion involving a number of people, those who are connected by shared activity, interest, or quality. Now, for example, I'll give an example. Should students go abroad for higher education? Okay, if this is the topic given. So I'm having this discussion in my class where my students are there and we are connected by one topic. That is the topic I gave just now. And what is this? Some are going to speak for, some are going to speak against. So that is the meaning of group discussion. When you are conducting a group discussion, you have to give a chance to everyone to speak. That is why when I have these group discussions in my class, I make them raise their hands, you know, and let them talk. So when one student is talking, the teacher is listening and the other students are also listening. Listen respectfully, respectively, and participate actively. When one student is speaking, you have to listen to that student, give respect to that student, jot down the points where you feel that he or she, you are not agreeing with that person, and you also take part after he or she finishes. Criticize ideas, but not individuals. Don't criticize the person. How did she speak? She made so many errors. She was lousy in speaking. No, you will criticize only the idea, not the individual. Commit to learning, not debating. We are committed to learning. We have to learn lots what the person is saying from. Avoid blame, speculation, inflammatory language. Don't use any language which is hurting, okay? And don't blame any person. And from what the person is saying, don't start speculating that person. Avoid assumptions about others, especially based on their perception. Now, if somebody is saying, yes, one has to go abroad. So don't assume something about that person because that person has said this. Maybe he or she will not go in the future. Today she's saying that. And don't assume something based on the perception, what that person is saying. Based on that, don't form assumptions. It's a very, very important thing. When you are talking, not only in this debate, not only in this group discussion, when in future, when you will go for job interviews, always look into the eye of the person. Even if you are wrong, Even if you say, I don't know, say, I don't know. But look into the eye of that person and say, I don't know. Because when you look into the eye of that person, that shows that you are a very, very confident person. And if you don't look, then what the impression is that the person is lacking confidence. And that could be a negative point, negative mark in the aggregate when they are judging you. Do not look at the evaluators only. When a group of people are sitting, say three of you have been called to for group discussion, especially when you go for these after your MBA job, MBA exam, entrance exam, they call for a group discussion. So there will be three, four of you together. So look at your partners, look at the evaluators, keep your eye moving, you know, so that shows your confidence. Initiate the group discussion. Initiate the GD is a big plus. You have to initiate it. Never keep it in mind that the initiate the discussion only when you understood the topic clearly and have enough. Keep it mind that when you have understood the topic clearly and you have a lot of knowledge about this topic, then only initiate. Don't initiate and stammer and stumble and stop. Don't do that. Be courteous. Even if you feel you strongly oppose somebody, but you have to be courteous. Now, why I'm doing these points, I hope you understand, because you have to remember these points when you're going to write the group discussion. That is why these points are being discussed. You have to be polite. Pay attention to your body language and be confident. And so when you're going to write this group discussion, you have to be courteous. Because it will be a group discussion. The topic will be discussed amongst your friends, amongst two people, or you and your friends. You have to remember, you have to be polite when you're talking, when you're writing the script, and you have to show your confidence in the script also. Okay? Okay. Next, we go to email. Now, email is very, very, I think you people know better than me what is an email, why we use it, and all these things are given. So let me go to the next point. Okay. Electronic mail, also known as email or email, the dash. One of the most commonly used service on the internet, allowing people to send messages to one or more recipients. And it was invented by Roy Tomlinson in 1972. Now, why the operating principle behind email is relatively simple. It quickly made it the most popular service on the internet, and you have to make sure that your email stand out because of the content and not because of sloppy mistakes. Don't make any grammatical mistake or spelling error. The formatting should be very, very correct, and you're writing it for an exam purpose. So don't use a casual language. You have to be very, very formal. When you're sending an email to your friend, you can write anything, whatever way you wish to present. But when you are writing it for the exam purpose, your language should not be a casual language. Okay, so email, here I've given it. Include a clear subject line in your email. There should be a correct line, you know. There should be, use the subject line to summarize why you are emailing. Now, when we write a letter, we write subject. Supposing I'm writing a letter to the corporator, telling the corporator that near my place, the garbage bins are not being cleaned. So my subject will be overspilling of garbage bins. So here, I'm going to summarize my entire email content into one line. Appropriate salutation. So, hello, here, whatever question has been set, to whom you are addressing the email. The first paragraph of your email should include information on why you are writing. Be clear and direct. Why are you sending the mail? That has to be very clearly stated. The next section or middle para of your email should describe what you have to offer the employer, or if you are writing to ask for help, what type of assistance you are seeking. Means the middle paragraph will be the content of your mail. What is the topic? What is the subject that you have mentioned? Keep it flawless with relevant punctuation. Very, very important thing. That is, there should be no mistake. I keep on saying the same thing. There should be proper punctuation mark. Conclude your email by thanking the employer for considering you for the position or your connection for helping with your job search. So conclusion, whatever you have concluded, you conclude the mail thanking the person to whom you are writing, and the signature, the first name, email address, phone number. This is regarding a company loan. Now this I will be explaining later when we'll do the question, you'll solve the question paper, then you'll come to know how exactly what is the format of the email. And finally, the email address, your email address and the phone number and the company logo. If it is a company, then we need a logo, otherwise just a signature, nothing else. Okay, so this is email. Okay, next is report writing. Now, report writing, we have two types of report writing. Report writing is a formal type of writing elaborately on a topic. The tone of a report is always formal. Example, report writing about a school event, about an incident that has taken place, and about a business scare. Now, here we have two types of report. One is newspaper report, and the other one is report for your college magazine. Now, newspaper report is what? When we get the newspaper, we see different things happening all around the world. So, how is it written? So, it is divided into four parts. The first part is the headline. The second part is dateline. The third is the lead or the introductory paragraph. And the last is the main body. Headline. What is the headline? Headline is the main attraction of the news. The moment you read the headline, you come to know that yes, the news is about this. For example, please don't talk, children. Please don't talk. So the what is the headline? For example, we say Mumbai Indian wins IPL. So that is the headline. So immediately we know the news is pertaining to the IPL match that just recently concluded. So headline. Headline is always, always written in bold and large type of writing. It's written in bold language, bold letter. It should be in present tense. Always remember, we will say Mumbai Indians win. We will not say Mumbai Indians had won or won. No, present tense, active voice. Mumbai Indians win IPL. Not IPL was won by Mumbai Indians, active voice. No articles will be given. The word should be very, very vivid and concrete. What do I mean by vivid and concrete? The moment I read the line, I know what is going to be the news. And headline will always, always be written in capital letters. Next comes the date. The date, the dateline will be written, date of name of the place, where has it taken place, the month, and the date when the incident has taken place, and agency. Agency would be, say, for example, TOI, Times of India. Sometimes it is the Times of India. Sometimes it will be staff reporter. Then we have the lead paragraph. Lead paragraph is the introductory paragraph, as it is said. And the lead paragraph will always answer the questions who, what, when, where, and how. So in 30 words or in 3 sentences, your introductory paragraph will be written. So if I take up, say, for example, bank robbery, a case of bank robbery. When did it happen? Where did it happen? So when, date, time, where is the place, and how did it happen? All these, the main part will come in 3 sentences in the first paragraph. Then we have the after the lead paragraph, the lead paragraph will be having these points. I mean, the most important point will come in the first sentence. Second sentence will be the important. Third and fourth will be the less important and the least important. This is how the lead paragraph is going to be written. And where is that other thing gone? 1 minute. Lead paragraph and the main body. And the main body, I think I made a mistake. Very sorry. Very sorry, children. Lead paragraph, I have written in 3 sentences. After the lead paragraph comes the next paragraph, that is the body. In that body, you are going to mention the details of the news, where the most important point will come, then comes the next important, then comes the less important, and then comes the least important. So if I have written my first paragraph in 30 words, my remaining only two paragraphs, you're writing it only in two paragraphs, this will be written in, say, 90 words. So my newspaper headline report will be written in 120 words, not more than 120 words. Okay. Another one will be college magazine. Another report will be college magazine. That will be written in 3 to 4 paragraphs. Now, what do I mean by college magazine? College magazine is my magazine, my report. What is happening? College magazine will be, supposing I write a report on college festival, your college festival. So in that, you will just write your festival name. Say Tarang. Tarang is your festival name. So as you are in the first paragraph, you're going to introduce this festival. When did it take place? You're not going to use empty words which have no meaning. You are going to use the order of importance. For example, the first paragraph will be, when is this Tarang festival held in your institution? What is it? What is the festival about in one sentence? Then the second paragraph, you will be talking about what programs are you having? Fine arts? Are you having performing arts? Okay. So what are the, what programs are you having in performing arts? Dance, you're having a skit competition, you are having music competition, etc. In finance, what competitions are you having? Then these two paragraphs will be, you're describing the festival. When you are describing the festival, you have to use again active voice, very short sentences. Okay, do not try to impress anybody, but you have to express what is happening. And a fact should be very, very correct, because you're writing it for the college magazine. Don't add any fiction. And don't give any opinion about anybody. And then after the first paragraph is the introduction, second and third paragraph, you describe your events. And the fourth paragraph, you conclude. You conclude by giving a very, very positive, message, you know, that what all good things happened during this festival. It brought the people together. Everybody worked in cooperating with each other. The talents were exhibited. So this is going to be your conclusion. And in the end, you're going to write by student reporter, nothing else, by student reporter, and the heading and the conclusion. Okay. Then I come to, after this, 1 minute. Okay. Then we come to interview question. Interview. Now, interview questions, that is, you are to interview a person. You can be asked, you're going to interview a cricket player, a cricketer. You are interviewing a doctor. You are interviewing a social activist. You are interviewing your own teacher, etc., etc. So what are the areas that you are going to cover? You are going to ask about their achievements. You are going to ask about any obstacles if they had met in their lives. You are going to ask about obstacles and or they struggled and setback, if they faced any setback. Inspiration. Who were their inspirations? Teacher, parent, anybody else, you know, friend. How was the journey? And what are their future plans? These are the points you're going to cover. Time management, you know, time management in the sense, here it is for the exam purpose. It should be only in 8 to 10 sentences, but restricted to 8. Don't exceed beyond 8. That is your target for the exam. Now, make the interview interesting. Ask about funny incidents that took place in the life of a person. You can ask them if anything funny has happened, if anything interesting has happened. And when you are conducting the interview, then you must remember that you must show your confidence. You must speak very politely. And one more thing which you have to remember, when you are asking these questions, all your questions should begin with WH. WH, that is, now the very, very common tendency is, supposing I'm interviewing my, I'm interviewing my a person who is a football player. Okay, so you played football and put a question mark. That is not a question. Did you play football? You won the college tournament. Did you win the college tournament? Your coach was Mr. XYZ. No. Was your coach Mr. XYZ? Are you following? Every question should begin with a WH question. It should be a WH question. Who, when, how, why, where, etc. You went to Pune for the finals. You put a question mark. That is not a question. Did you go to Pune for your finals? Where did you go for your finals? Like that. Is it clear? So every question should have a question interrogation word. Don't write a sentence and put a question mark and say it is a question that I've asked and you get less marks. No. Why has the examiner not given me marks? You're wrong. You have to ask a question and then you get an answer. Okay. So this is my next comes my speech writing. My speech writing is speech writing. There could be, before I begin, yes, there could be different kinds of speeches. Okay, before that, it will be written in four paragraphs. You'll have the address, you will have introduction, you will have body, and you will have a conclusion. Now, address. Address means what? It will be good morning, good evening, also good afternoon. Also, you can add, there's no harm. Now, there are different types of, there are four or five I've mentioned, five types of speeches. Five types of speeches means I am giving a speech at an elocution competition. I'm giving a speech in my college during the morning assembly. I am the CR of the class and I'm addressing my friends. I am giving a welcome speech at an annual day function and a general speech. These are the kinds of speeches you may get for an exam. When I am delivering a speech at an elocution competition, whom all I have to address, apart from your good morning and good afternoon, I have to address the honorable judges, respected teachers, and my dear fellow students. These people I have to address. So first paragraph, you are writing this. Then, speech at a morning assembly in your college. Some colleges have this system that once a week on Monday, one student every Monday, they will come and deliver some speech on some current topic. So in the assembly, who all are present? Your principal, honorable principal, respected teachers, and my dear fellow students. CR of the class, you are the class representative and you are having a blood donation drive in your college and you have to convince your friends. So my dear friends, then welcome speech at an annual day function. That is annual day function. You are giving the welcome speech. So who all are there? Chief guest, guest of honor, parents, teachers, and my dear fellow students. General speech. General speech will be ladies and gentlemen or dignitaries on the dais. So this is the general speech. So first comes the address, then the introduction. You will introduce whatever it is. Like for example, if you are giving a speech at one, I'll take up morning assembly, you are contesting for the post of a head boy. So that will be your introduction. Today I'm here standing in front of you to deliver a speech. As you know that I'm contesting for the most coveted seat of this institution, that is the head boy or the head girl. Body. Body means you describe what all you have to talk about. If it is your speech for the contest, for contesting as the head boy, head girl, then you have to talk about what all things you have done for the institution, what all things you will do for the institution, etc. And conclusion. Conclusion could be that if I am selected, I promise that I will do my best to carry out all my wishes and my promises. Okay, so that is the conclusion. Okay, then we come to the next, that is comparing. Comparing. Now, what is comparing? Comparing is when you are comparing for a program. You are comparing for your annual day. You are comparing for your prize distribution program. You are comparing for your sports day. So, what should a compeer should be having a deep knowledge of everything. Presence of mind is very important. He or she should have a presence of mind because there will be changes made in the last moment. Should be very, very confident. And the body language should be, as usual, very, very good. And he should have a sense of humor, not be mechanical and just read the script and finish it. Sense of humor. So what points are you going to include? First, you will be introducing introduction. Say it is a prize distribution program. So you'll be introducing, good evening, good afternoon, everyone. And we have all assembled here to, which is say 20th prize distribution function of your college. So first, after introduction, you will call someone to deliver the welcome speech. So the person will be delivering the welcome speech. Then you will be calling somebody to light the lamp. Lighting of the lamp. Why is it done? To evoke a gratitude towards, say, for, it's an educational institution, to eradicate darkness and to bring in the knowledge of light. Then you thank the person. Thank the person for lighting the lamp. Thank the person for delivering the welcome speech. Then we have the welcome song. A group comes, or 3-4 students come to sing. Then comes the event, you know, surprise distribution event. You read out the names, you read out the percentage, you read out the subject, everything. All details are given. And finally, you call somebody to deliver the vote of thanks. Okay. And then you conclude once again, ask them to stand up for the national anthem, and your comparing is done. So you will be asked to compare for a prize distribution function. So you have to remember all these points. You will be introducing, writing and welcomes, short welcome speech, you're calling somebody to deliver, then lighting of the lamp. These points will be given in the question paper, and you have to highlight these points. All these points will be given in the question paper. Okay. Then we come to expansion of idea. Now, expansion of idea is the idea, the proverb will be given. As you sow, so you reap. I take it from Inchcape Rock. As you sow, so you reap. Generally, you just say it is a proverb, it is a saying, which is very, very apt in our day-to-day life. Then you talk about the introductory paragraph. Explain that meaning of the proverb or the saying. Then you core paragraph. Core paragraph could be two paragraphs. One is one is just talking about the proverb. Second is explaining the proverb. Third and fourth will be, you can cite examples. Give examples which are appropriate, linked with this, as you sow, so you reap. You can give any anecdote. You can give any example. And finally, you give a concluding paragraph that it is a very, very apt proverb in our day-to-day life, and we should all remember it. And it should be very, very clear. Your thought should be very, very clear. And also keep the thoughts in a continuing process. And any idea that you wish can be assimilated, and express the statement in complete sentence. Don't write just, you know, scattered sentences, but write them in complete, meaningful sentences, because you're explaining and you're going to give examples also. Okay. Then comes, introductory paragraph. I've given a little more depth into it. Okay. Idea. Symbolism should be clearly understood. What is the symbolism behind this? As you sow, so you reap. Given idea, hidden idea, whether it's the literal meaning, metaphorical meaning needs to be given, if there is at all. The given idea needs to be well evaluated and interpreted in the introductory paragraph. As I said, explain it. Just explain it very, very clearly. Then comes the core content. Give instances, anecdotes, as I said, example, unity and clarity of thought, typical link between two points with proper punctuation. And remember the central idea, more important ideas, more space, and less important ideas, less space. So most important, important, least important. And don't give too many ideas. Don't give too many ideas, but restrict it in two paragraphs. And finally will be your conclusion, where you will conclude a suitable and relevant point. And another proverb you can also give, which is similar in meaning to the one given. As you sow, so you reap. So you can give a similar meaning, a similar proverb with the same meaning in the concluding paragraph. Okay. Then we come to film review. Now, film review will be only a film. This is children are a little confused about this. The question given will be a film review of a film that you have seen. We can't set a question by asking you to give a film review of a film. I name a film and say half of you have not seen, not heard of it. It's not possible. So film review will be on only in very, very general a film that you have seen, but points will be given in the question paper. So what points are you going to analyze? The film, the characterization, or we begin with the plot. What is the plot? What is the story about? Who, what are the characters? How is the cinematography done? Picturing, etc., etc. How is the music and sound, music director, and how is the entire music of the play? How is the direction done? How is the director? How has the director done his job? Director's job is done excellently, okay, good, etc. What about the actors? The main actors, the second range of row of actors. How have they done their job? How is the script, the language, etc.? The genre. Which genre does the story belong to? And the plot analysis. So all these points have to be covered. You can begin from the genre, the plot. How is the plot? And what is the meaning of plot analysis? You have a character. The character is rotating around the events. How are these? Whether it's very absurd, whether it's very abrupt, you know, the plot and the character, the plot and the story. Then how have the characters enacted themselves? Are they vivid? Are they able to bring out the theme, the emotions, etc.? Cinematography, I told you, the sound and music. How has the director done his job overall? How have the characterization and acting go together? And how is the script written? So this is your review question. Okay. Then we come to blog writing. Now, blog writing, again, is something new. I hope you know what is a blog. Okay, we go like this. What is a blog? Blog structure, writing blog posts, etc. What is a blog? A blog is a shortening of weblog in an online journal. Is an online journal. Online. Everything is online. There could be a blog on, say, food. A person who is very good in cooking writes about cooking as her blog. Or informational website displaying information in the reverse chronological order, with latest post appearing first. It is a platform where a writer or even a group of writers share their views on an individual subject. Okay, so individual, as I said, cooking. One could write on cooking. One could write on travel. One could write on communication skill. So all these are the topics of blog writing. Each entry, and the entry is called a post. It's called a post. Okay, then what are the common features that a typical blog will include? There's a header, the headline, with a menu or navigation bar. Sidebar with social profiles, favorite content, or call to action. Footer with relevant links, with a disclaimer, privacy policy, contact page, etc. There'll be a headline. There will be a sidebar with the social profiles who look into your blogs, who read it. And there will be a footer. That is the conclusion. This, when I'll write the answer, you'll understand what exactly I mean. Okay, when you are writing a blog, how blogging can benefit your personal or professional life? Express yourself and share your passion. Passion for, say, sports. You're writing something on sports. So express your view and you show how passionate you are. When you are writing, you should be different from the others. It should not be a stereotyped writing or copying from anybody. Go to the net and copy, and then you say, this is my blog. No. Make it interesting. Give some personal sharing. Give some personal experiences. Refine your writing skills. It is being read by thousands and thousands of people. So it should have a good flow of language and good writing skill. Build your professional network and earn more media exposure. The more, the better you write, the better appreciation you get. And the more you become professional. So this is what you should remember when you're writing a blog. Plan your blog post by choosing a topic, creating an outline, and conducting research and checking facts. You have to give facts. Don't give anything wrong. No wrong information should be given. Otherwise, immediately you will be caught. A title should be very, very attractive. Draft a headline that is both informative and will capture the reader's attention. As I said, for headline also, the title should be very, very informative and very, very attractive. Have an introduction lead and concluding paragraph. The same as newspaper headline, there should be an introduction, there should be a lead, and there should be a concluding paragraph. Add your personal experiences. Because when you are writing something on sports, you know a lot. So you may give your personal experience. But in newspaper headline, everything is factual, no fiction. Use images to enhance your post, improve its flow, add humor, and explain complex topics. Use short paragraphs, simple and short sentences and words. So your post should be interesting. You could add humor. The paragraph should be short. The sentences should be short and limited number of words. So this is your blog writing. Okay. Edit your blog post. Make sure no repetitions. Read your post aloud to check its flow and end your post with a discussion question. So this is done. Now appeal writing. Appeal writing is something very, very important. A very important, nice question. This is appeal. What is an appeal? When you are appealing to some group of people or a person about to bring about awareness. I can talk about environment pollution. I can talk about dowry deaths. I can talk about the bad effects of smoking, etc., etc. So generally to make the people understand that something wrong is going on in the society and you and I can be a part of it to bring about a change. So to create social awareness, as I said, to involve people in general social activities. When I am sending them an appeal about keeping my environment clean, I can involve people in it. To make people aware of social problem, as I said, environment is one, smoking is one, problems related to girl child. So I can make them aware. To encouraging them in trying to solve the problem. I am asking them to please help me to solve the problem. To motivate them to take part in movements. I am conducting some, I will not say exactly movements, but take part in my donation drive, take part in my mission, take part in a rally that I'll be conducting, etc., etc. For that, I'm going to write an appeal. Okay, how do I go about it? These also may be given in the question paper. I have to have a slogan, a very, very catchy slogan. Sometimes the question is said that you have to give a logo. A logo is a symbol associated with your... Now, for example, if I say environment and I talk about cutting down of trees, I can draw a tree, I can draw an axe, and I can show drops of tears falling from the branches of the tree. So that is my saving the environment. Talk about the problems. What problems are we facing because of cutting down of trees? Environment not taken care of. Heavy rain or some places drought. Okay. Then you can talk about pollution. You can talk about leading to pollution. Okay. You can talk about this pollution leading to lung-related diseases, the problems. Solve problems. How can we solve problems? We can solve problem by, say, planting trees on, say, Republic Day, Independence Day, Gandhi Jayanti, saplings. Let us all plant saplings. Appeal to the reader. Directly appeal to the reader. Seek reader's participation. I'm holding a rally. Please come and join my rally. Or I'm having a magazine. I've given one example. I'm having a magazine, say, Vana Patrika. You write, you contribute by writing. I'm having a small bank. You know, I have a bank account in a bank. So contribute some amount so that I can carry out these programs. Then I'm having a rally. I'm conducting a rally. When I'm conducting a rally, where is my rally starting? Who all will be there in the rally? What time is it starting? From where? And where is it ending? And who are the people who are going to be a part in this rally? And you appeal, you write it in such a way that it really appeals to each and every person. So this example I've given, these are the points given. These points will be given in your question paper. Prepare an attractive slogan, persuasive appeal, programs, contribution, need to save the environment, and add your own ideas. And this is my answer. This answer is given. Dear friends, I've addressed them. What all I'm doing? Tree plantation projects, Van Mahotsav, street play, journal, bank. So donate generously. And whom I have to contact, XYZ, a mobile number for further details. Okay? Okay. Next one. Next one. One minute. Just let me check. One minute. So we have finished all these four A, B, C, D. I finished all these. Now we come to question number five, the last section, section four. Now, section four is very, very important in the sense you have to remember this, children. First time this new pattern is being set. There is one. This is the novel section, history of English novel, and we have question number B, C, and D. All the four lessons, history of English novel and the remaining three stories, there will be no extract. You have to remember all the three stories and history of English novel. Just remember and answer the questions. There will be no extract given. I hope I'm very, very clear. So you have to read it and you have to know it very well. Okay. Now here, 1 minute. Sorry. Okay. Here, what will you get? You will get complete the activities given below as per the instructions. Activities on history of English novel and activities again on history of English novel. But the questions will be on MCQ or match the column, chronological order, true, false, etc., elements of novel, etc. This question 5A will be history of English novel. And I have made this. What is a novel? History of the novel. What is novella? Famous novella. Okay. This, you just go through this. This, whatever form you can say this is, this you please go through. And there is no need for you to go through the text. Only for history of English novel. History of English novel, you don't read. Just go through this PPT of mine. That will be enough. You'll be able to answer any question that comes from there. Okay, then I'll come to the next one. Yes, now BCD. BCD will be same, but from three different stories. The questions will be on plot, structure, theme, setting, language, character. So all these questions, all these subheadings are given in your textbook. You have to know which are the questions on plot, which are the plot will be where the events are being, you know, events are put up with respect to the characters. Theme is the theme of the story, the theme of the story. Structure is how the writer has divided the story into parts and how they connect, you know, how the theme is connected and from one phase to the other. And then we come to the conclusion. Setting is where is it taking place, the backdrop. Theme is the central topic and the subject and the message. Okay, the language is what? It's the kind of language in the period to which the text belongs. It is the language of that era. And character, who are the characters and what characteristics do they have? Okay, so all the remaining three lessons, B, C, D, will be on each one, and the questions will be based on plot, structure, theme, language, character, but it will not be repeated. If for the first lesson, to serve with love, that's the first lesson. To serve with love, if they have set a question on describe and illustrate, the next lesson, they will set a question on explain and interpret or compare and narrate. And the third lesson, they will set a question on say, contrast and justify. So none of the questions will be repeated. Character is set on one, then a character question will not be set on the other. But you have to know each and every question every lesson thoroughly. Then only you will be able to write the answers, because lessons, no stories, extract will be given. Am I clear? I hope I'm clear. Okay. Then I'll just brush up with your the blueprint. Yes. Blueprint, prose, marks is 34 and 34 with options. Poetry, 14 marks, 14 marks. Writing skill only, what I told you, that is, there are 12, but you have to answer only. 12 questions will be set, each one carrying 4 marks. So 48 marks question, but you will be answering 4. So it is 16 marks you're answering. And novel genre will be also only 16 marks. Clear? And then this is per question. percent in. This I think you, it's okay. I mean, you can just go through it. That's it. Thank you. Any doubts, children? Anybody has any doubt? Bole ma'am, do we have a doubt session?
There. With the see
chat box in the chat box.
They have this on the chat box. They have written.
Okay. Where is the chat box?
Ma'am,
I'll tell you.
On the group later.
Okay. Yes, I got.
Are they going to give two brief answers for 50 words each or two activities?
Yeah. Will you please send these PPTs on the group later?
Yes, we will send the PPT.
Okay. For 5B, they are giving to give two brief answer for 50 words for each. Yes, 50 words for each. That is given in the question paper. 5B and 5C and 5D will be all 50 words question. Okay? 50
yeah.
50 words. Okay. In 50 words.
What about time management?
Something about film review. Yes. A film review, can we just prepare for one film? Yes, you can prepare one film and you can be ready with it and the points will be given. No, so stop the error. No, point the error. There'll be only one error. There'll be only one error. Time management, as I said, whatever the number of words are given, please stick to those many words. Don't go beyond it. So 50 words will be 4 sentences. 30 words will be 2 sentences. So don't elaborate. Be very, very precise. And especially this fifth question, you have to be very, very thorough with the lessons. Only when you're thorough, then if this then give you a question on Denham from the first To Sir With Love, you should know who is Denham, from which story, what are his characteristics. So it should be at the tip of your finger. Then, for example, if they ask you a question from this the next lesson, that is Around the World in 80 Days. Okay, they ask something on Mr. Fogg, did Mr. Fogg win the bet? So yes or no? What was the mistake? Where did the mistake lie? The mistake lay in the time factor. They did not understand that when they were traveling towards the east, they gained by one day. So the lesson should be very, very thorough for the fifth question. Okay. And for writing skill, as I told you, writing skill, when you will get the model answer paper, then you will come to know how long and how short should those answers be. So please stick to those model answers, then you will not have any problem with time management. And once they write the paper, once they write one paper, if they have any time management, Gole ma'am, they can always contact me. Then I can help them out. Yes, 5A.
Yeah, sure.
In 5A, there is no descriptive type that I told you. It will be MCQ or match the column. Understood? Trupti has asked me this question. Okay. Anything else? Any other doubt? Any other doubt?
Students, get your doubt clarified. Will you please tell which writing skill options you will prefer?
Which writing skill you want to, I personally feel you should go in for, yes, you go in for message, virtual message. This is easy. You can go in for interview question. That is also very simple. Then speech writing has, I have given the format. And appeal is also easy. Or review, you keep a film review ready. So film review. How much is the total?
How much total marks is deduction?
Deducted.
Deduction.
Deduction.
Yeah. Deducted. The question is not very clear.
Huh? What do you mean by deducted? I told you, if you write a very correct answer out of two, you get 1.5. And the 4 marks question, if it is absolutely correct, if the examiner may give 3 or 3.5. Okay, and I prefer the writing skill will be virtual message, interview, speech, and a review. These are the easy ones too, but you prepare at least 2 from each set, if not 3, at least 2 from each set. Total deduction, I didn't understand the total deduction. What about remaining orals? Orals is 20 marks. That is the same format. orals will be of total marks. Highest score we can score in English, the highest score is 71. If it is 71, it goes to the chief moderator. 70 plus goes to the chief moderator. 70 plus goes to the chief moderator. And if your answer is absolutely correct, it remains 71. Otherwise, they bring it down to 69. So 91 is the highest every year in the boards. 91.
How should we prepare for novel section?
Novel section. I told you, novel section. Novel section, you have to read. You have to read the novels very, very thoroughly. You have to go through all the questions at the back of the lesson. It is given character, setting, theme, everything is given. So please stick to those questions, because this time mostly you will get questions from behind the textbook. Everything is given under these subheadings: plot, structure, theme, setting, language, character. You just read, you will understand. And if there's any doubt, you can always contact me.
Okay, students, any more questions?
Can you please tell me how many paragraphs need to write the appreciation?
Those and points, that points you, first two points you combine. 1 minute. Minimum length required in for critical summary and expansion. I've given you that. See, 1 minute.
Students will send you the PPT. Don't worry about it. Mrs. Bhattacharya, don't worry. We will send them the PPT. They can
send them the PPT. Okay.
Yeah. We are going to send.
Then, if any doubt is there, I'll clear it out.
Yeah. No problem.
Okay.
Now, only film review or book review can also be asked.
No, not only film review, not book review. It's film review. It's only film review. I told you. Okay. Hello.
Okay, students, all good?
I have to make an announcement.
Yes.
Yeah.
Students, as we had told you earlier, the revised board paper pattern for few subjects were pending, and now we have received the revised paper pattern. So we will be sending you the PDF form of English, Hindi and electrical maintenance paper 1 and paper 2. You will get it today, or by latest by tomorrow you will be getting your papers on your mail. Please attempt those papers, and then you will have to submit it along with your other answer papers on the 29th itself. Clear? And history, logic, economics is already given to you. Art students, you already received these three papers. As and when we get the remaining subjects, because they are also getting ready, we will start posting it to you. So these three papers are going today itself. You will receive those papers. And with this, I wish all of you a very, very happy Diwali.
Goli ma'am, 1 minute. Critical appreciation, I've brought that slide here. Children, please see. Poem, title and theme. Make it as one paragraph. The first 3 points, one paragraph. Poetic style, language, next paragraph. Special features and message, third paragraph. And last is your opinion. Have you got it? So till theme one. Poetic style, language, second paragraph. Features and message, third paragraph. And opinion is conclusion, last paragraph. Okay?
I think computer science, electronics is pending because the revised thing is not come from the board.
Electronics and computer science has not come from the board as yet.
Yeah.
So those three are pending. Remaining rest of the papers are getting ready. So we will keep sending them. I think let them enjoy the Diwali. But today they will get those three papers. Remaining papers we'll send them next week.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you so much, Sheila Madam.
Welcome, ma'am.
Very, very, very good session. Excellent session.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
You have not only helped the student, you have cleared my English again. Oh, whatever I had forgotten, it is brushed up again.
Thank you so much, ma'am. My pleasure.
And though due to technical snag, we couldn't see you, we heard you loud and clear. Thank you so much.
Welcome.
Yeah, it was a wonderful session, Srila.
Thank you so much.
We really enjoyed every word of it.
Yeah, yeah.
Welcome, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Students, hope you all also enjoyed. And happy Diwali to you all. Happy Diwali, Veena madam, Srila madam.
Wish you the same, ma'am. Happy Diwali.
There's one question from a student. Are we going to have a French guidance lecture? Yes, you will definitely have French guidance lecture because we are waiting for the format to come. As and when we get it, we will send it to you. And
okay, let us conclude this session now.
Yes. Thank
all
you.
Good?
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Yeah.
Bye.
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 Sagamaa.